Good afternoon. Thank you for everybody for finding the time and visiting today's webinar. My name is Cesar Zaka. I'm a consultant neurologist at Al Zahra Hospital. And now we can make sure that everyone can see us and hear us well. It's okay now? Do you hear me?
Yes, doctor.
Yes, doctor.
Okay. So today we are going to discuss the new anti-epileptic therapy, sharing experience from clinical practice. And please, for everyone, make sure to press the mute button during the lecture. And when the speakers are done, then you can proceed with the question and answer session. If you have any questions, simply press the unmute button. You can ask or you can go ahead with the chat box. If you haven't registered yet, please comment your full name, job title, company, email address, and mobile number. Now, the topic will be spotlight on the S-L-carbazepine acetate, sharing experience from clinical practice. I will introduce Dr. Vicente Villanueva. He's a neurologist at the neurology service in Hospital La Fe, Valencia, where he became a staff member since 2004. Since 2005, he has also worked at the multidisciplinary epilepsy unit at Hospital La Fe, where he is head of the refractory epilepsy unit and epilepsy surgery program. He serves as a representative of the European reference network, EpiCare. He is also an associate professor of neurology at the University of Valencia since 2017. Dr. Villanueva is a member of the AEG board and the Epilepsy Guidelines Board of the Spanish Neurological Society. He is a reviewer for Neurology, Epilepsia, and Epilepsy and Behavior, Epilepsy Research, Acta Neurologica Scandinavica, and European Journal of Pediatric Neurology. In the last years, Dr. Villanueva has directed 9 epilepsy courses, authored 85 papers on epilepsy, and has served as editor of 3 books on epilepsy. Dr. Villanueva was awarded in 2014 with the Scientific Prize in Epilepsy by the Spanish Neurological Society. So I welcome Dr. Villanueva, and the platform is yours. Thank you.
Hello, good afternoon, good evening for you. Can you hear me well?
Yes, we can.
Okay. So first of all, I would like to thank Dr. Zaka for the introduction. And I would like to thank also Prof. Farma and Bial for inviting me to participate in this meeting. And also to all the physicians and nurses in Emirates, in Dubai, that are joining to this meeting today. I want to thank all of them for participating. Particularly, I want to thank the health system community all over the world. After this very difficult situation we have faced, all of us in different countries, with this coronavirus pandemic, that I hope in Emirates and in Dubai, I think that you are doing better. We have had very bad time here in Spain, but we are also recovering, hopefully, in the upcoming weeks and months, things will be better for all of us and our families. So, and after this, I would like to share with you over the next hour what is our experience with different clinical cases from my clinic and from my hospital. This is my hospital, the one you can see in front in the first slide. We are a reference center in Spain, one of the centers that are recognized by the Ministry of Health as specialized in refractory epilepsy. We have referral from all over the country, and our main commitment is to deal with difficult cases in epilepsy. So as I mentioned, I would like to share our experience through clinical cases and some publications that we have done with S-L-carbazepine acetate over the last year, and other colleagues' publication to try to convey our experience, our humble experience with this drug, and maybe it could be helpful for some of you. Okay. This is my interest. I will start with the first case. I think that we have the question and answers by the end of this presentation, but if something has to interrupt or something like that, maybe you can use the chat and I can stop the presentation. It will be fine. You can stop me if it is okay for you, if you want to. I will start with the first case. This is a female, 20-year-old, right-handed at the moment. We attended this woman for the first time. She started having seizures, having epilepsy at the age of 6 months. She described, and the family described, episodes of lack of awareness. But she didn't start treatment until the age of 2. And he was started on carbamazepine and clonazepam. And she suffered for a couple of years. And unfortunately, after being seizure-free for, she was seizure-free for 10 years. At the age of 12, seizure reappeared. And unfortunately, the patient was not able to control epilepsy. The seizures started with an aura, and afterwards, patient became unresponsive, left mouth deviation, oral automatism, postictal amnesia, and she had episodes, monthly episodes, 3-4 seizures per month. And at this point, she was taking carbamazepine when the first time we saw this patient, levetiracetam and zonisamide. And in the past, she has tried topiramate, clonazepam, fenobarb, valproic acid, and oxcarbazepine. Those medications didn't work in this patient. Regarding the antecedents, nothing relevant in pediatric history or in family history. She was in good health other than epilepsy. And she had some school difficulties and she had a sheltered work. But unfortunately, after having so many seizures, she has to leave work. So, this is the EEG, the interictal EEG. If you see here, you can see left temporal spikes in this double Manana longitudinal montage, bipolar longitudinal montage. Sorry. These left temporal spikes with slow waves in the left temporal side. Okay, so, and this was the seizure. We admit the patient at the video EEG. This is an all patient. This is our all video EEG unit. And this is what we collected from this case. We collected several seizures. All of them were similar. Some of them were complex partial. Another were secondary generalized, but the onset was similar in all of them. See this seizure. The patient has lack of awareness, automatism, manual automatism, left head deviation, and at the end, she had a generalized tonic-clonic seizure. A secondary generalized tonic-clonic seizure. You can see here that this was a bad seizure for this patient. And after having this, she was having seizure, monthly seizure. Not all of them were secondary generalized, but many of them were. And that was the reason she was referred to our center to evaluate the option in this case. I will show you the MRI. Sorry, first of all, I will show you the EEG, the ictal EEG. You can see that in the left side, in the left side, it is a ictal rhythm and ictal onset. You can see here this delta theta rhythm that is increasing in the left side. It's increasing, you see here in this seizure. So it looks like to be a left temporal epilepsy. Also, this secondary generalization make less possible that it was a mesial epilepsy. Probably it was more neocortical because she had a lot of seizure, and this is typical from neocortical epilepsies. So when we went to the MRI, we could see this left temporal blurring in the MRI, in the water, in the white matter and the gray matter. You can see the difference between the right side and the left side. So there was probably a dysplasia in this side. You can see here that it was like not easy to distinguish, but this blue, blurred temporal, left temporal lobe. As it was a left temporal epilepsy, we should take care in terms of memory, probably possible memory deficit, considering epilepsy surgery, as this patient has failed 7 antiepileptic drugs, and as we observe left temporal seizure with a left temporal lesion in the MRI, we decided to move or to go to epilepsy surgery. As I mentioned, we wanted to have some caution considering verbal memory. This patient had also a verbal memory deficit that could be explained because of this left temporal epilepsy. And we observed in the fMRI a bilateral language. It seems that this patient over time has moved language from the right left side to the right side. It can be the language activation in the frontal, but also in the temporal region. So looks like that probably was not so bad considering epilepsy in terms of possible deficits. At this point, we use subdural electrodes. We are not using this type of electrodes anymore, as we are using intracranial electrodes, depth electrode, stereo electroencephalography at this point, but this is an old patient and we use subdural. We implanted 2 subdural grids and we observed that in the yellow spots, there was an interictal discharge when we monitored the patient and we did a video EEG when the subdural electrodes to evaluate epilepsy surgery. We observed that there were some language in this red spot. Although there were a bilateral activation with a right predominant, there were some language in the left side, and these were the area where seizure came from. So at the end of the day, we performed a left temporal resection, not as big as we wanted because of these language areas that not so predominant, but as we observed a few language areas, we decided to do a small resection. And this patient was okay for 2 years. But unfortunately, after 2 years, seizure reappeared and she had 1 seizure per month. One seizure per month, 1 complex partial seizure per month. And our patient was on this combination. So what we do for epilepsy surgery after epilepsy surgery is seizure reappear. It is quite possible that this patient becomes seizure free with some changes in the medication, because epilepsy also is still not fully responding to epilepsy surgery. Is more possible to respond to antiepileptic drugs than in the past. So at this point, we decided to go to a, let's say, easier chain, an in 2 weeks, we converted this patient from carbamazepine, 1200 milligrams, to eslicarbazepine acetate, 1200 milligrams, plus levetiracetam and zonisamide. And fortunately, this patient became seizure-free and was fine for years. And this patient is seizure-free at this point after many years after epilepsy surgery, probably 10 years or so. And after readjusting the medication with eslicarbazepine, probably this patient is 8 years seizure-free. So this made me to go to some papers about what are the differences between eslicarbazepine, acetate, carbamazepine, and oxcarbazepine. It is clear that it is not the same drug. There are different generations of a family of drugs, the dibenzazepines. And the main difference in terms of chemical structure is in the 10 position of the ring, where there is, you can see the difference between carbamazepine and eslicarbazepine acetate. This hydroxy 10 ring position, this hydroxy terminal is different, and then make the difference in terms of chemical structure and can explain why these drugs are not behaving in the same way. The main difference in terms of mechanism of action is that eslicarbazepine acetate is a prodrug that is converted to oxcarbazepine and eslicarbazepine. And eslicarbazepine by itself has a mechanism of action different than carbamazepine. Carbamazepine is more active in the fast inactivation of the sodium channels. However, eslicarbazepine, similarly to lacosamide, has an effect in the slow inactivation of the sodium channel. So this can explain why these drugs are not the same and can work in a different way in a patient. The other differences between these three compounds are in the number of intakes. Carbamazepine has 3 intakes, oxcarbazepine, at least the oxcarbazepine we have in Spain is 2 intakes, and eslicarbazepine acetate is 1 intake. In terms of metabolism, are the other differences that are particularly important considering side effects. Carbamazepine is metabolized to 10-11 carboxy epoxy, and oxcarba and eslicarbazepine has a similar metabolism. However, the main differences is that the active metabolizer, that is eslicarbazepine, is higher considering eslicarbazepine acetate than oxcarbazepine, and the metabolism oxcarbazepine by itself is higher in oxcar considering eslicarbazepine acetate. This higher proportion of active metabolites and less proportion of oxcarbazepine can also explain the differences in action and in adverse events, as we will see later on. And what is the experience that has been reported considering carba, oxcarba, and eslicarbazepine? There are several papers over the last years that have tried to show some differences between these drugs. If we move to carbamazepine and we go to all the studies that were done in the 90s in the all veteran system in the States, one of the main problems of carbamazepine is the hepatic toxicity that make this drug, this proportion of 4% of patients with hepatic toxicity in this clinical trial compared to valproic acid. This hepatic toxicity can be explained because the metabolism in the liver of carbamazepine, and this could be reflected also that the levels of cholesterol can be higher with some enzyme inducer antiepileptic drugs like carbamazepine. These drugs with a high enzyme induction property or high that with a lot of induction in the liver makes that some pathway of the metabolism of some drugs and also some products that are produced by our body, like cholesterol, can have disturbances. And can explain, for example, that in patients with carbamazepine, metabolism of cholesterol could be changed and the cholesterol level could be high. This can be improved with drugs like eslicarbazepine acetate that has not so this high or this strong property in the liver of enzyme induction. And to prove that, this paper from my colleague in Barcelona, Rodrigo Rocamora, showed that in patients that were taking carbamazepine or oxcarbazepine and were switched to eslicarbazepine acetate, decreased the cholesterol levels and the triglyceride levels in this population. That could be explained because the properties, particularly compared between eslicarbazepine and carbamazepine, of enzyme induction is better for eslicarbazepine. The other problem that has been seen with enzyme induction, with drugs that work in or that have a strong enzyme induction, like carbamazepine or like phenytoin, for example, is that with this drug, cholesterol can be high, but also some problems can happen in the vessels, particularly in the carotid artery. It's been studied that in patients that are taking enzyme inducer, there was an increase in the intima media thickness compared to patients that are not taking antiepileptic drug with enzyme induction. In this paper that was published by other colleagues in Spain, Dr. Serrano Castro observed that in patients that were taking enzyme inducers, there were an increase in the intima media thickness compared to those that were not taking, that were taking non-enzyme inducers. In the group of enzyme inducers was included carbamazepine. In the group of non-inducers was included eslicarbazepine acetate. This increase of the intima media thickness is associated to an increase of problems or cardiovascular problems. And this is particularly important in men compared to women. The other problems or the other side effects that, in my humble opinion, can be different from carba and oxcar compared to eslicarbazepine are cognitive disturbances. The cognitive adverse events are very important as epilepsy is a chronic condition and it's going to be with patients for years, then it's very important to have drug with few cognitive problems. Carbamazepine has proved to have cognitive issues in 18% of patients in this study, in the study I mentioned before. And what happened with oxcarbazepine? There is a very interesting study that was published in Epilepsy a few years ago in volunteers that were taking eslicarbazepine compared to volunteers that were taking oxcarbazepine, 7 patients in each group, to observe adverse events, dizziness, headache, fatigue, and nausea. So what it was observed is that in patients taking oxcarbazepine, the possibility of having this adverse event, this neurological adverse event, was much higher than in those taking eslicarbazepine. And the reason of that can be explained here in the metabolism. You can see here what happened with eslicarbazepine as compared to oxcarbazepine and to eslicarbazepine. And it's been seen that the eslicarbazepine was similar with the two drugs, with eslicarbazepine and with oxcarbazepine. Eslicarbazepine is inactive, so it's not a problem. But the peak of oxcarbazepine that is much higher in CSF of Oxcar compared to eslicarbazepine. Thus, in explanation can be can explain or can is the what can explain the peak of dizziness and more adverse event that has been observed with oxcarbazepine to compared to eslicarbazepine acetate. Finally, to finish this group of studies, we have observed in our study of our group, early study, that in patients with focal epilepsy after first monotherapy failure, that for those patients that converted from with carbamazepine or with oxcarbazepine to eslicarbazepine acetate, because of adverse event, most of them eliminated adverse event, not all of them, but many of them. And in terms of compliance, for patients who are taking only that were taking eslicarbazepine, the possibility of compliance and taking the medication better was much higher than for those taking carbamazepine and oxcarbazepine. This is the, those are the patients that reported compliance problem with carbamazepine or with carbazepine, and there's those that reported with eslicarbazepine acetate. So with this, all this set of slides, I want to prove that eslicarbazepine is better. I can prove that. I can prove that it's different than carba and oxcarba, and maybe for some patient it is more interested to switch from carbamazepine or oxcarbazepine to eslicarbazepine, particularly in my humble opinion, because there are less adverse events and because efficacy can be different or can be better or can be different for some cases. Just to finish, the way to do the switch with Oxcar, as the similarities in the chemical structure and in the metabolism is overnight, and the chain can be done one per one, the same dosage of Oxcar to Esli, and overnight switch can be done. And carba and Esli carbazepine is 1.3, and in this case it's 1 to 2 weeks to change. This is there are different publications. As the one I show you here, this is a group of experts that we published a few years ago, this paper. Let's move to the next case. This is another case. This is a male, a guy of 7 year old, young male that she started having seizure at the age of 15. The first seizure came is playing video games in an adolescent, that is quite frequent, at least in Spain, to play video games at this age. And he had an episode of left head turning, bilateral tonic posturing, and was not started with medication, but at the age of 16, he had an episode of unresponsive autosome automatism and mild postictal confusion. So after this point, he was started on medication. And to start on medication, we should consider that this patient had a left kidney agenesis and has visual disturbances, so had other comorbidities. And the most important in this patient is that he was a premature. He was born at 7 months, low weight, and had delayed milestone. The reason probably was a cytomegalovirus infection, CMV infection. And because of that, he had some intellectual disability. And most importantly, probably in this context, he had behavioral disturbances that make difficult to treat this patient. Regarding neurological examination, was normal other than a mild bilateral ptosis, left more than right, and MRI was normal. And this is the EEG that was also normal in this case. So, regarding the medication, he was started treatment in other centers, was started levetiracetam 500 milligrams BID. This is probably the most frequent way to start treatment in Spain with levetiracetam. I don't know if it is the same in Emirates, but this is at least the most frequent in Spain and probably in Europe too. And with this dosage, he did well in terms of seizures and irritability at the beginning. He did well in terms of seizure, but he started to have irritability at the beginning. Because of this irritability that was seen with levetiracetam, that is something that has been seen in many patients, he was changed by his physician at this point to valproic acid, 600 milligrams BID. With this dosage, seizures were fine, no seizures. However, he started with cognitive disturbance because of valproic acid and weight increase and hair loss. Weight increase was a problem in this case because was a little bit obese, the patient, so he was starting trouble with that. And he came to our clinic and we decided, after these two medication, and we decided to start eslicarbazepine 800 milligrams bedtime once per day. We withdraw valproic acid and without seizure for 2 years, no cognitive disturbance, he did well, and no problems with weight in terms of evolution of the epilepsy. This made me to put on the table the problem of psychiatric comorbidity and intellectual disability. What is our experience with eslicarbazepine acetate in this field? We did this study in the last years. This is probably the study that collected more patients in real-world data in clinical practice with antiepileptic drugs in the last year. We did an European study, pulling studies from different European countries. We coordinated this study at our center in Valencia, in Spain, and we were able to collect 2,000 patients from different databases all over Europe. As you can see, these European countries, most of them part of the EU. And this is the demographics of the patient, 2,000 patients. And moving to the point I want to present here, we have 11% of patients with intellectual disability from the group of patients that reported they have or not intellectual disability. And psychiatric comorbidity was seen in nearly 1/4 of the cases in the group of those that reported if they have or not psychiatric comorbidity. So in summary, we have 283 cases with psychiatric comorbidity. That is quite high, but it is what is happening in epilepsy. Many of our patients have psychiatric problems. Many of them have psychiatric problems. And we have to deal with that with epilepsy treatment. So this is the type of psychiatric issues they have: anxiety, panic disorder, everything, depression, everything, every type of psychiatric issues. So what we observe in this group of patients is, and we published this second paper regarding psychiatric problems, in last year in Journal of Neurological Science. This is that the number of responders and seizure freedom was similar considering psychiatric comorbidity or not. This is interesting because if you observe most of the results with all the antiepileptic drugs, outcomes are worse in patients with psychiatric comorbidity. It shouldn't be worse because psychiatric comorbidity is not per se related to refractoriness, or is not something that per se is related to not responding to antiepileptic drugs. But for some reasons, those patients with psychiatric comorbidity respond worse overall. with most of the antiepileptic drug. In our case, we observe that response were a little bit better in those without psychiatric comorbidity, but was similar in the group with psychiatric comorbidity, considering S-dicarbazepine acetate. However, the most important, in my humble opinion, is that the problems on the number of psychiatric issues, psychiatric adverse event, was similar for those patients with psychiatric comorbidity and those without psychiatric comorbidity when we treat this population with S-dicarbazepine acetate. We published this information last year, and in my humble opinion, sodium channel blockers, those drugs that work in the sodium channels as S-dicarbazepine acetate, are particularly interesting for patients with epilepsy that have also psychiatric comorbidity and particularly depression. Let's move to other case. Case number three is young male, too, 20 years old. When we first time see this boy, he had a problem at the age of 50 days. He had a brain hemorrhage with bilateral frontal and parietal, needed surgical evacuation, but unfortunately in this context, he had a bilateral infarct of arterial cerebral artery and the right medial cerebral artery, a Sylvian stroke of the right side, and he had a big disability with intellectual disability, also some disturbance in terms of behavior, and he had a seizure. There is a question here. Something, want to ask something? It's okay, should I move forward? Okay, I move forward. Okay, sorry, if you want to, just tell me if you want to ask me something. Also, we will have the question by our moderator at the end of this meeting, Maui Awacher. Okay, so let's go back to the case. He was started at that point with phenytoin, 300 milligrams per day for 1 year. And after 1 year, he was okay and phenytoin was withdrawn. This is something that is done in many patients, but the problem in patients with an hemorrhage, with a big brain scar, a big brain porencephalia, that seizures can appear in a few years, can happen in a few years. This patient was, as I mentioned, dependent, school for disability, and was quite reluctant to take any type of medication. And this is the examination. He had a dysarthria and left spastic hemiparesis. And the MRI has a bilateral infarct in the territory of the anterior cerebral artery and the right Sylvian artery. And EEG had right hemisphere sound waves. So this is the characteristics, a young male, focal epilepsy, intellectual disability. And seizure, as I mentioned, reappeared 4 years ago, secondary generalized tonic-clonic seizure. And at the beginning, parents were reluctant to treatment, to start treatment. However, after a second seizure, 1 year later, oversleep, also a generalized tonic-clonic seizure, he was started on S-dicarbazepine 800 milligrams bedtime. Why I started S-dicarbazepine? You know, I started this drug because this was a focal epilepsy, and I think that in this type of epilepsy, sodium channel blockers are particularly good. And because I wanted something easy to take in this case of with intellectual disability and difficult to take medication. And one medication once per day is also probably quite, in my humble opinion, quite appropriate in this group. He's been doing well. And as we mentioned before what is happening with psychiatric comorbidity, intellectual disability, but another topic that I would like to come up is the post-stroke epilepsy. What is the experience of post-stroke epilepsy with sleep carbazepine acetate? We have published another paper. This is the poster of this paper that it is in press right now. In epilepsy and behavior. And in this case, we observe that when we compare post-stroke epilepsy patient with those without post-stroke epilepsy patient in the big database I presented before, the European database, in terms of effectiveness, seizure freedom, and responder rate, was quite good in patients with post-stroke epilepsy. So it seems that in this population that is not difficult to treat because most of the post-stroke cases we face respond quite well to the medication, but because of the fact that it is a drug that is given once per day, we wanted to be sure that it was working in this population, and this was the case, it was working. It was not surprising, as I mentioned, because this population is quite sensitive to medication. However, we wanted to be sure that in terms of adverse event, and this population is quite sensitive to adverse event, the population, the patient with a stroke are sensitive to adverse event, we wanted to be sure that this was the case with sleep carbazepine acetate, and we observed that the number of patients that reported adverse event was quite low, or similar to the number without post-stroke, and if you take a look of the main side effects are similar in the two groups, as is 7% of dizziness, the main side effects, and somnolence probably is the most frequent effect that we saw in the group of post-stroke epilepsy. However, when we took a look of discontinuation because of adverse event, was similar in the two groups, even was not similar, was worse in the group without post-stroke epilepsy. This is probably related to the numbers that are not comparable in the two groups, but nevertheless, we can observe that in the group with post-stroke epilepsy, the number of discontinuation was quite low. So it is possible, or it is at least our experience, that this drug, it seems to be interesting in this group of patients, those with after a stroke, as the patient, the poor guy I presented before. Other group that we wanted to analyze was the one with elderly patients, those older than 60 years. Just to make a quote here, or to make a pause here, and to that, if we take a look of the epidemiological studies that has been done in the past years in epilepsy, the only group of patients that increase numbers in terms of epilepsy is the elderly. So the other group, the other age group are similar, even some of them are lower in terms of number of patients, but the group of patients with epilepsy in the elderly is increasing. So as other diseases in all patients are increasing, and also epilepsy. So probably we are going to see a lot of epilepsy patients in the elderly in the upcoming years. So in this group, we observed that the response was quite good compared to those that were younger. So it is another group interesting to treat. And again, in this group, we observed that the side effects that are particularly important in this group of patients, in this group of older patients, was similar a little bit higher, but similar to those younger. The only side effects that we observe that we should be more cautious is hyponatremia, as patients older than 60 years could be more or could experience more frequently hyponatremia compared to those younger with slicarbazepine acetate. And particularly, if the patient is taking diuretics, we should take care and take a look in the sodium of these cases. Let's move to other case. This was a female, 20 year old. She was having some episodes a little bit crazy at the age of 14. Were described overnight as leg movement and unresponsive. The duration was 10 to 12 seconds over the night, during the naps. Two, in the transition of sleep and wakefulness. And at the beginning, she was diagnosed of anxiety. At the age of 15, she had a generalized tonic-clonic seizure, but it was with fever during holidays. She was in London, Christmas holidays, and had this seizure. And reported also an episode of bilateral tonic posturing and head deviation. This was very confused in this patient. The past history was unremarkable, other than was a premature, delivery was at the 30 weeks, and was a low weight. But she was a good student, a normal young woman, and so everything was normal in her. And neurological examination, brain MRI, EEG was normal. So at the beginning, she was started with treatment. She was diagnosed of anxiety, as I mentioned, and she was started with bromazepam, a benzodiazepine. She did well. She didn't do well, as she was having daily seizure per night, funny episode, poorly described. And after this episode that I described before of this generalized tonic-clonic seizure with fever, this episode of some tonic posturing, but not fully clear, she was started on levetiracetam, as I mentioned, the most frequent drug for starting epilepsy in my country. And unfortunately, she was having daily seizures. So then she was starting on bromazepam, again to the benzo, because was not responding, and seizures were similar, and then she was referred to our center to perform epilepsy, to perform a video EEG to clarify the situation. This is the video EEG of this patient. You can see these episodes overnight. The patient was sleeping. And in the middle of the sleep, you will see something. Episodes were similar for this patient all the time. Patient awake. And see the face. This face is typical of epilepsy patient. This like face of a scare, fully disconnected, lack of awareness, and this hypermotor movement. This possibly this is an automatism, but not fully clear. And the seizure is brief and early recovery. All of you probably know that this is typical from a frontal epilepsy. This is the ictal EEG. You can see here this frontal, bifrontal, left more than right ictal onset. And this was a left frontal epilepsy. Typically, left frontal seizures are difficult to distinguish from non-epileptic seizures, as probably a few patients are diagnosed of anxiety, so it's not rare to have this diagnosis. We admit patients with a diagnosis of pseudo seizure, non-epileptic seizure a few times, and at the end of the day, it was epilepsy, frontal epilepsy. So this was a young female, frontal epilepsy. She was a good student, so we wanted to treat this patient more effectively. So as a frontal seizure and a frontal epilepsy, we wanted to start a patient with a drug that was effective in frontal seizure, and we decided to start with a sodium channel blocker. And we decided to start with sleep carbazepine. The reason of that is that it was easy to take, only once per day, bedtime, and we didn't want to have cognitive adverse events, as we have proven with this drug in many patients before. And the patient responded quite well. She is seizure-free for 5 years, and no side effects, is living outside, is an international student, is having normal life. So this young woman could come up with a couple of topics regarding this drug. First of all, what is happening with pregnancy, and second, with oral contraception. So far, the experience with pregnancy is reduced with this drug, probably as it is similar to Oxcar and to carbamazepine, that are drugs, let's say, appropriate for pregnancy. This drug could be appropriate, but we need to pull more experience in the future. And the experience that has been published so far comes from this paper, patient from clinical trials, and that became pregnant. There were 79 notifications of pregnancies exposed to sleep carbazepine, clinical trial and post-marketing experience. 30 kids were born without problem. 25 were ongoing at the time of this publication, and 3 were unknown. There were 8 induced abortion, 10 spontaneous abortion, and 5 malformation. Also, in these 5 cases with malformation, there were not a clear-cut relation with sleep carbazepine. And those with S14, all 11 out of 15 of cases with a spontaneous abortion or with malformation were on other antiepileptic drugs. So this is the experience we have. It seems that could be fine, that could be appropriate, but we need to accumulate more experience. In my personal experience, we have not had problem with the drug in the patient that have had pregnancies, but we need to refer to European, to international pregnancy registry to accumulate more experience. Regarding oral contraception, that's, it's another problem that can happen in this group of young women. Patients that are taking sleep carbazepine can have 50 micrograms estrogen if they are taking oral contraception. Regarding what are the outcomes in clinical practice, I will refer again to this group of this population, this study of 2,000 patients, to emphasize that is quite effective, as we see in this patient that I proved, what I mentioned. This is the number of median and mean seizure reduction, considering not only easy cases as the one I presented before that was monotherapy, but also difficult cases. That is quite interesting. It worked in different type of seizures, simple, complex, and secondary generalized seizures. Something interesting is what are the best combination with sleep carbazepine acetate. Anything is possible, but in our humble opinion, the combination with non-sodium channel blockers seems to work quite well, particularly with levetiracetam. The combination with levetiracetam has been appropriate for many patients in our experience. And probably the most interesting in this big database that we published is that there were few adverse events. And this is something to be considered in a young woman like the one I presented, as for being treated for years, as these women, young women, we need something without adverse event. And in my humble opinion, this is the best scenario for sleep carbazepine acetate. This patient in which we want to avoid, we can't allow to have adverse event, as tolerability is quite good. In this group of patients, 2,000 patients, we observe just 6% patients with dizziness being the main adverse event. And there were few important adverse events, no liver problem, no unexpected adverse event in this study. Let's move to the case number 5. And when we are moving to the last part of my presentation. This is a male, 43-year-old male. This is a typical patient that probably many of you see in your clinic. And probably in the mid-age, you have many of these patients. This is a businessman. He had at the age of 40, a subarachnoid hemorrhage, no aneurysmatic. And at 1 year later, he started having at the age of 41, hot flashing episodes with body slowness. And at the age of 42, these episodes were followed by unresponsive. And even some of them were followed by head turning and unresponsive. So, as I mentioned, this guy was a businessman, an entrepreneur, successful guy, and he came to our clinic with his stressful life, and I say to him, you have epilepsy. After this, we did this examination, everything was normal, MRI was normal other than a few white matters, subcortical hyperintense lesion, but not very relevant. EEG showed this left temporal slowness, this theta waves and these left temporal spikes. And I say to him, you have epilepsy and we have to treat you. He told me that he is gonna do what I say, but he asked me to give him something easy to take, and he was traveling all the time, having this stressful life, and for him to have adverse event was not acceptable, or was not very acceptable. So that's the reason I decided to start him with sleep carbazepine, one tablet per bedtime, 800 milligrams. And I've been following this guy for years, for many years, and he's been doing well without seizure, without adverse events. And this is an example of, in my humble opinion, the best group of patients for sleep carbazepine acetate that are the monotherapy patients based on the few adverse events. There are a few studies in monotherapy in clinical practice. This is the study that we did a couple of years ago. We published last year in Epilepsy and Behavior in this publication that you can see here. And we included patients with sleep carbazepine acetate in monotherapy followed for at least 1 year. But many of them were followed either for 2 or 3 years. And we collected, this is the higher database in monotherapy, the largest database with more than 400 patients in monotherapy followed over at least 1 year. And first thing is that many of them remained with the drug over 2 years. So it seems that tolerability is quite good. And the most important in monotherapy, in my humble opinion again, is that 800 milligram, one tablet bedtime is fine for this patient and for this drug. And this is quite interesting in monotherapy. in this study, we observed that most of the patients that were converted to monotherapy, because some of them were starting in monotherapy from scratch, but other went in other drugs, then was added eslicarbazepine acetate, and then was put on eslicarbazepine monotherapy after withdrawing the other medication. Most frequently, they were taking levetiracetam, carbamazepine, valproic acid, lamotrigine, and oscarbazepine, but number one was levetiracetam, as that is the most popular drug in Europe. The effectiveness was adequate. More than 60% of the patients were seizure-free for the last 6 months, considering the whole follow-up, and considering from day one to day 700, more around 50% of the patients were seizure-free. And again, the most important is the few adverse events, and very few patients reported adverse event and led to discontinuation. No adverse event that could be considered as unexpected or that led patient to hospital or hospitalization or so. So this is the last case. I'm talking for 1 hour. I try to finish in 10 minutes to leave time, to give you time for questions. This is a pediatric case. This is a male, 90-year-old. The indication of pediatric cases is available in Europe and also in the United States from the age of 6 and from the age of 4, depending on the agency of approval. And this case was seen in our clinic at the age of 9, but he reported neonatal seizure when he had 1 year. And at the age of 4, he started with episodes that were described as confusion, agitation. It's quite difficult to classify. Maybe they were seizures, but it was not clear. However, at the age of 5, he started with episode of left motor focal hemibody seizure that needed rescue medication. Sometimes he had a tonic seizure for 1 minute, even he needed rescue medication sometimes. Neurological examination was normal in this patient, other than a mild hand paresis, brain MRI was normal. Sorry for the phone. Regarding the medication, when he had neonatal seizure, he was treated with phenobarbital. It's still quite frequent in my country to treat patients with phenobarbital in neonatal. It's probably changed to levetiracetam in some cases, but still frequent sometimes. As I mentioned, he was treated with that, and after a while, he was changed to levetiracetam. When seizure reappeared, this in fact happened when seizure reappeared at the age of 4, and at the age of 5, was having 2-3 seizures per year. We're not really doing too bad at that point. However, unexpectedly, this guy at the age of 5 being treated with levetiracetam was doing well, but when he came to our center, a few years later, he was having 2-3 seizures per month. Initially, was increased up levetiracetam to 30 milligrams per kilo, but was not effective of this seizure, for this seizure that seems to be frontal seizure, as this left hemibody seizure with focal component. And we decided to change the medication. The other problem that this patient have, and it's something that I have repeated in some cases over this presentation, is irritability. Irritability is something that happened in some cases, some patients with levetiracetam, and in this patient, other than not having seizure under control, the mom reported this side effect when he came to our clinic. So we decided to start with one sodium channel blocker, effective for focal seizure, and with few adverse events. That was the reason we started with the sleep, and that was easy to take. We went up to 23 milligrams per kilo. Dosage could have been increased to 30 milligrams per kilo. However, was enough with that. The patient is doing well and is not having adverse events. And this is another scenario in we have to use also sleep in pediatric patient with focal epilepsy. And just to show you a couple of papers that probably will have more interest for pediatricians that attended this meeting. First of all, in this very wise study that was done by this group of the Netherlands and the UK, that what they did was to see what is happening in patients that have psychiatric issues with levetiracetam, and then they change this patient to eslicarbazepine acetate, as I did in my case. And at the end of the day, the outcome was that those cases that were switched to eslicarbazepine acetate because of psychiatric issues with levetiracetam did well, and did like those patients without psychiatric issues with levetiracetam. So it seems that increased problems in terms of psychiatric issues or psychiatric side effects compared to levetiracetam. And in my humble opinion, we should think in a sodium channel blocker, and of course we could think in sleep acetate when levetiracetam is not working because of adverse events. And to finish with the last paper that was done in pediatric epilepsy, this paper is part of a randomized controlled trial that was done to prove efficacy in pediatric population. And it was observed, interestingly, that in terms of adverse event, probability of having adverse event with eslicarbazepine compared to placebo in add-on therapy is similar. Only the episodic memory index was worse with eslicarbazepine than with placebo, but was not statistically significant. And only the quality of working memory was statistically significant, but the whole neuropsychological evaluation was similar with placebo and with eslicarbazepine, so it seems that it's okay. And to finish with effectiveness, that is was adequate and then led to the approval in pediatric population compared to placebo in terms of risk seizure reduction and responder rate, regardless of the weight of the patient and of the age of the patient, starting from 40 years. Maximum dosage in this patient was 30 milligrams. There were a few cases with more than 30, but most of the patient, in my opinion, could be with between 20 and 30, at least for those cases, not as difficult to treat. And just to finish with also, I'm working in epilepsy. I would like to show you some experience also, a couple of papers in neuropathic pain. This indication is not approved in Europe, but there is some experience in patients with neuropathic pain, like trigeminal neuralgia, with eslicarbazepine, in patient that has failed carbamazepine or gabapentin on pregabalin, This is a Spanish study that proved an improvement in intensity of pain, and another study on neuropathic pain, also done in Spain, that proved also an improvement in the scores of pain after using these drugs, that probably similarly to carbamazepine could work in patients with neuropathic pain. But as I mentioned, this is not approved in Europe. And just to finish with my conclusions, this drug is, in my humble opinion, in my clinical practice, with some cases, is particularly good in a special population. Psychiatric condition, cognitive adverse event are unfrequent, and then is useful in this group. Tolerability, in my humble opinion, is better compared to carba and oxcarbazepine. The most important is to pick the right patient to use this drug. Post-stroke patient is a population that could be responding to this drug. And finally, monotherapy is a scenario where a drug given once per day, that is taken once per day without many adverse events, is particularly interesting. And thank you very much, Shukran. This is something that all the people did during the worst phase of the pandemic in Spain. All of us went to the street to clap at 8 p.m. overnight to try to fight against the coronavirus pandemic. This was something that make us to feel more optimistic at the very bad moments we had. And thank you very much again. This is my group, my team in Valencia. And I'm open for question. I hand over to the chairman, and thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Dr. Villanueva. I see that there was a question about the risk of osteoporosis. So what do you say about that, please?
Okay, yeah. Regarding osteoporosis, this is something that needs time to be seen, because it's a side effect that is appearing very slowly in the patient. What we have seen so far is that with drug with a strong enzyme induction properties, like for example, carbamazepine or phenytoin, in the database that has been published so far, there is a higher risk of osteoporosis. There are some databases that prove that. In fact, I had a few slides in this presentation regarding osteoporosis, but I removed because there weren't too many slides. So osteoporosis is being increased with carbamazepine, with phenytoin, with this drug, with a strong enzyme induction. And what I do in my patient, in this, particularly in women near menopausia, is to start with calcium and to start with vitamin D in this group of patients. So what is happening with sleep carbazepine acetate? What we have, our experience or our observation, is that it's not such a strong inducer as carbamazepine. Outcomes in this setting should be similar to those that we have seen in cholesterol. And in our experience, presuming we have seen with cholesterol, we consider that in terms of osteoporosis, it shouldn't be a drug so bad or so dangerous as carbamazepine, or that is clearly related to an increase of osteoporosis. However, as I mentioned, we need more time to see what the publication states in terms of osteoporosis with sleep carbamazepine acetate. But this is our thoughts with these drugs.
So for young people, do you start them also on calcium when you start the sleep carbazepine, let's say at 15 years or?
Not at all. I'm using calcium and only with strong enzyme inducers like phenytoin, carbamazepine. I wouldn't say that I start this calcium supplement before the age of 40. After the age of 40, I think about that, and particularly in women. If it is a patient with a high risk, I start before, but otherwise I don't. But I always recommend to my patient to have a diet with more calcium, with milk, with cheese, with all these products that seem to have more calcium. Because this osteoporosis is something that it is not seen in the patient, but it happens over time. Mm. And what I do is a densitometry in my patient when I decide, or after the age of 40, or particularly in women, I recommend to the family doctor to measure the calcium in the bones in the patient. But I have to confess that it is not a clear policy, not even with rheumatologists, regarding when to supplement calcium in patients that are taking medication, enzyme-induced medication. But this is my experience.
Okay. There is a comment by Dr. Kumar. Nice to know your experience in post-stroke epilepsy. You spoke about that, but I don't know if he means if he needs special comments about that or regarding other medication. I'm not sure.
Okay, I think that this is a group of patients quite interesting that is increasing, because our patients with a stroke are survivors right now. Because we do a lot of therapies, we do thrombolysis, we do many things. We have a stroke units. And in this setting, these patients have more possibility to survive. And in this case, have more possibility to have other problems like epilepsy. So in this setting, in this group of patients, we need drugs with few adverse events, because many of these patients have problems with tolerability, with co-medication, and so on. So, I have experience, as I conveyed over in this presentation, with sleep carbazepine acetate, as I have also experienced with other new antiepileptic drugs. And this drug with low enzyme induction, without too many adverse events, or with few adverse events, are particularly interesting. Something that should be considered with sleep carbazepine acetate is what happened with anticoagulants, particularly warfarin or derivative of warfarin. What is being seen is that with sleep carbazepine acetate, the interaction with warfarin is not relevant. So it's not related to big changes or to even to adjustment of warfarin dosage. Nevertheless, as when we start a new medication in a patient that we is taking warfarin, we should refer to the family doctor to adjust or to take a look. However, it's been seen that there is no changes in not big changes, that the change that is being seen is very small in the warfarin level when it is started, the patient are started with sleep carbazepine acetate. And this is something important with in post-stroke patient. What is happening with the new anticoagulants? We don't know, but we don't know with none of the drugs, as we need more experience to see the interaction with the new anticoagulants and the drugs we have for epilepsy. But our first thought is that those drugs with few interaction, like sleep carbazepine and like the new antiepileptic drug, seems to be better in this setting. The only thing that we should consider is to take a look of sodium, okay? Because particularly if the patient is taking a diuretic, we should at least do one blood test to see if the sodium is doing better. We have not observed big issues, and we have not observed big issues that require hospitalization or so at all, but I recommend to take a look on that.
What about contraceptives? Do we need, in this case, to have two modes of contraceptives if you are using escitalopram?
Yes, we need to use a higher dose of estrogen, okay, 50 milligrams, because the enzyme induction, or we'll use other methods for contraception. However, this is something that we can speak, or we can talk to our patient, as if the patient is not using contraception, oral contraception, in my humble opinion, it is a drug quite interesting for young women, because it's very easy to take. And then if I have a patient that is taking, a young woman that could be taking oral contraception, the day I start medication, I have a conversation about this, and then it is decide what to do. But if it is taking oral contraception, we should use higher dose of estrogen if it is oral contraception. Okay, 50 milligrams of estrogen.
Now, there is a question from the organizers. What is the experience of ESLI in bipolar patients?
Okay, unfortunately, I'm not a psychiatrist. My experience is pulled from the epilepsy field. But what we have seen is that in epilepsy patient, is doing well in terms of psychiatric comorbidities. So we can make this assumption that it could work in psychiatric comorbidity. It's been published something in depression. And in fact, when we participated in the clinical trial, we used scales of depression, and patient did better in terms of depression using escitalopram acetate. So, as probably psychiatrists are using everything to treat bipolar disorder patients, and it is frequent that they use sodium channel blockers like lamotrigine, like carbamazepine, why not using escitalopram acetate? Because the experience that we have pulled, at least in patients with epilepsy and psychiatric comorbidity, is okay. So why not? It's an option.
Sure. There is another question. Can you add ESLI with levetiracetam at the same time? I think you answered this question very well. I don't know if you have any other comment about that.
Not many. It's a good combination, two different mechanisms of action, and it is when I have a patient with LEV, I try to combine with sodium channel blocker. Of course, ESLI is a good option.
How do you overcome, this is my own question, how do you overcome the sleepiness and the somnolence that happens with ESLI carbazepine in the beginning? Because some people may complain quite a bit, I mean, especially that one dose a day.
What I recommend is to do a slow titration, to start with 400 milligrams and to spend maybe more than 2 weeks in 400 if you see that it's a very sensitive case. And to take the medication at bedtime, when patients go to bed, not in the over dinner, but when they go to bed. With this adjustment, I have had better outcome. Another option is to have the 200 milligrams tablets. We have had these tablets in Spain recently, and this can help to start with the 200 and increase up the dosage a little bit slower. And this can help because sometimes if you start with the 800 milligrams, this can be related to more adverse events. Then slow titration is my recommendation.
How often do you recommend doing liver function test and CBC?
Okay, not many often. As in clinical practice, I do this once I start antiepileptic drugs. I do a blood test like 3 months after starting the medication. And if it is okay, I'm not doing this every year. Maybe once per year, but if it is a young person that is healthy, I'm not doing every year. But to give you a clear-cut answer, 3 months at the beginning and every year, every 2 years, over follow-up. The only exception if the patient is taking diuretics. In this case, I do this once per year, maybe twice per year, but not more frequent. Regarding liver function, I have not had problem at all with sleep carbazepine acetate in my cases, so it's not something that I should consider. Same with white blood cells. I have not had problem with a decrease of neutrophils or white blood cells with sleep carbazepine acetate.
I see now a question just came. Does the medicine have any effect for the neuropathic pain? Yeah, you mentioned that. For epileptic patient with neuropathy, I mean from your experience, also any effect on migraine with epilepsy?
Okay. I can say that it's not making migraine worse, but it's not a drug that has proved efficacy in migraine. But it is a drug that can improve neuropathic pain or can be useful in neuropathic pain. Sometimes of headache and like a mixture of migraine, tensional headache, neuropathic cephalalgia, something like that. So in these cases, I think it could be interesting. Of course, if you have a patient with migraine, at this point, I think there are better options that use antiepileptic drugs. And you have the option of using Botox or using biologics or other drugs. But if you are thinking an antiepileptic drug, it is an option. Okay. But
there is also a new question. In your experience, how do you differentiate non-epileptic seizures from frontal? Yeah, it's a well difficult question. Please.
How to differentiate non-epileptic
seizure from frontal?
Okay.
Yeah, this is a long topic.
Yeah, the only way is to do a video EEG, to perform a video EEG monitoring and to capture seizure, to study the patient, and then you can make the difference. Sometimes when you do the clinical history, it's not easy. It's not easy. And we need to admit the patient and do a video EEG. And I have to confess that I have failed in patients, and I have treated patients with epilepsy and they didn't have epilepsy, and the opposite. I have treated patients with pseudo seizure and they have. So video EEG, please. Video.
Will there be any benefit from carbamazepine? I think they mean maybe esli carbamazepine in non-epileptic seizure?
I wouldn't say that. Mm. If this patient is having other psychiatric comorbidity, it's okay. If not, my first recommendation will be to refer to a psychiatrist to treat, and a psychologist, maybe with psychotherapy. Sure.
Well, I don't think there is any more questions. I don't see any. So thank you very much, Dr. Villanueva. It was really a very interesting topic, very detailed, covered many issues within the same disease. So I thank you very much and hope we'll have a future nice topic again.
Thank you for your time, for your invitation, and hopefully next time we can see each other in Dubai, that everything is okay.
Okay. Yeah, sure. Thank you.
Bye. Thank you, doctors. Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Thank you, Dr. Vicente, and thank you, Dr. Cesar.
Thank you.